want people to have hope in the midst of, man, my loved one is dying and this part's really hard. You are not alone. He is at work in the midst of conflict to transform you even then.
Welcome to Building Relationships with Dr. Gary Chapman, author of the New York Times bestseller, The Five Love Languages. Today, if you're walking through a season of grief or anticipating one, don't miss our conversation. Our guest says that our lives can be transformed as we face death with loved ones.
Whitney Pipkin will join us today. She went through the loss of her mother, and through that deep valley, she really believes that death teaches us how to live. We're going to explore that today. And if you want to see our featured resource, go to buildingrelationships.us and you'll see the book beautifully illustrated on the cover, We Shall All Be Changed, How Facing Death with Loved Ones Transforms Us. Again, go to buildingrelationships.us. Dr. Chapman, react to that statement, death teaches us how to live. Do you agree with that?
I have to be honest, Chris, I haven't thought of it that way. but yes, with reflection on that, I agree with that. You know, it kind of puts things in perspective for us because sometimes we get so caught up in the day-to-day activities of life, you know, that we fail to think about the deeper meaning of life. So I agree with that. And I think this is going to be a great discussion. So I know that those who are listening today who have lost a family member are definitely going to find this helpful. And Let's face it, all of us at some juncture in life will face the death of family members.
Well, there's probably somebody anticipating that as well today. So listen up. If you go to buildingrelationships.us, you'll see our featured resource by Whitney Pipkin, the book, We Shall All Be Changed. She's a journalist who lives with her husband and three children in Northern Virginia. She writes for the Chesapeake Bay Journal, but you may have read her work in the Washington Post and National Geographic, the Gospel Coalition. She serves as the written content coordinator for the ministry Women and Work. You can find out more about Whitney and her book, We Shall All Be Changed, at buildingrelationships.us.
Well, Whitney, welcome to Building Relationships.
Oh, thank you for having me, Gary.
Now, you dedicated this book to the memory of your mom. You say she was, and I'm quoting here, the woman who always knew I could do hard things, but never wanted me to have to do those hard things. Tell me about your mom and a good memory you have of her.
My mom squeezed a century of life into her too short 63 years. Despite living under the shadow of cancer for 20 years, more than 20 years, mom was known for her this larger-than-life energy and her determination to do whatever it is that she set her mind to. So one of my favorite memories of her was seeing her take up a new hobby later in life. She had been very accomplished in a career as a banker, but she was the daughter of a professional artist and a hobby carpenter, and she just never considered herself as creative as them. And it wasn't till kind of that last decade of her life that in her empty nest years, she started taking up woodworking and connecting with the memory of her dad. And she found out she actually was really creative. So that was really fun. About a month before she died, she came out to Kansas from Kansas to Virginia to visit my family, even though she was really sick, not well enough to do that. And she came just so she could bring them this fairy house she had built that was from my grandma's old redwood fence. And it has this pine cone mantle, this pine cone fountain. And it was such a display of her creativity, her delight in her grandkids, and this new way she was expressing herself. And it's I keep reflecting on that after she's gone. What are the new things I've been afraid to try? And that's given me courage even to write this book or to do other things I thought I couldn't do.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned that she had a 20-year exposure to cancer. How old were you when you found out about her cancer?
I was in the seventh grade. My sister was in the fifth. In the book, I talk about kind of that scene that's etched in my memory of when she told us, you know, sitting on her bed after school one day. And really, I remember her being afraid. My papa had just died of cancer a couple years before, and that was her dad. And so I knew what that word meant. I knew that it could take her from us. although I couldn't imagine that happening. And I wrote in the book, and I'll just quote, you know, I remember feeling like she might evaporate from us at any moment. Like the mere idea of her not being here forever was enough to make her disappear right away. And little girls, we can't help but take our mothers for granted until suddenly we can't. And so at age 11 or 12, however old I was discovering my mom's mortality and the fact that she could be here one day and then not the next. And that was really life-altering.
Yeah. You know, we normally think in terms of a person dying much later than that. And when we realize that young in life that, you know, death is a reality. How did you respond emotionally to that as a child of that age?
I remember being scared. I remember her being scared, and so I was scared. You really reflect, I'm the oldest daughter, you reflect what your parents are feeling and emoting. And my parents were divorced and both recently remarried. So there were questions around where we live, where we go to school. You know, this would change everything. And, you know, and I was also in the seventh grade, so I was pretty self-consumed. I was really into hair and, you know, all the things that seventh grade girls are into. And I was into being in the center of attention. So there was an aspect of, gee, I'm going through something. And that felt kind of cool to be at the church retreat with this massive prayer request of my mom has cancer, you know. But it wasn't really until she began to lose her hair that newness faded very quickly and the reality sunk in. And that was the morning after Y2K, if you remember, when we thought maybe the world would end before it went to the year 2000. And I had a bunch of friends over for a sleepover. And that was the next morning is when she began to lose her hair. So it was coming out in clumps in the shower. And when she began to look sick, that's when it really began to impact me and in ways that I don't know that I could fully process then, but have been processing through this book and through looking back at those years.
Yeah. You make a case in the book that our culture, and even Christian culture, doesn't do a good job with facing death. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, on some level, I think it goes back to the Garden of Eden and the serpent whispering to us, you know, you will not surely die. And we want to believe that. You know, it's a lie that we want to believe for both good and bad reasons. Ecclesiastes says that eternity is written on our hearts. So at some level, we intuitively know we are made to live forever. And yet, because of sin and the fall, if Christ tarries, we will all face death in this world, and we will go through it ourselves. And so I think of, you know, what Paul says in the scriptures, I do not want you to be surprised by this or that. And I do think that people, especially Christians, should not be surprised by death, this side of the fall. Rather, it's something that we should take the time to be more prepared for theologically, just like it helps us to have like a theology of suffering before we are suffering. It really helps us to revisit our theology of death as a subcategory of that and to think about how could God be good in light of this? What could God be doing? And that's what that's the conversation I want to invite, especially Christians, but also non-Christians. I've seen in conversations around this topic that the idea of being transformed through the loss of loved ones is something that resonates broadly with people, that rings true with people who've been through it and that people who've really dealt with it. You know, there are people who don't deal with it. As many years, I did not deal with it and really face it and think through it. But there is a unique opportunity when we're broken open by loss for God to sow some new things in us and for there to be a new perspective on the life that we're left to live after our loved one is no longer here.
Yeah. So you're sharing this story in written form today. We're talking about your experience in this. What do you hope for people who read the book and people who are listening to us today? What do you hope will happen as they read or as they reflect upon what we're talking about today?
My hope is that people will see this as an invitation to a conversation that will ultimately deeply encourage and prepare them for one of life's hardest, most sanctifying, most expected trials, which is losing people around us, losing those we love. It's something that we will go through and that there is a design, even in, you know, when God turns something hard for good, there is a design and a kind of silver lining of the presence of Christ in this hardship, in going through death, a knowing of who Christ is, a sharing in his suffering that I really want people to show up for. I don't know what that will look like in their lives, but I know what it's looked like in mine, and I want to testify to the value, the spiritual value of entering into this process in the fullest way possible.
Whitney, I want you to react to a section where you write these words, and I'm quoting, "One of the hardest aspects of facing the diagnosis of the death of a loved one is that it's not about us, and yet it impacts us deeply. There were times I went to counseling because I wasn't sure how to feel. Times I needed spaces where I could be both grieving my mom's mortality and also, well, mad at her on occasion." Respond to those words.
The more I talk about this aspect of living with a loved one with a long-term diagnosis, the more I see that this is a common experience for people who have a loved one with a chronic disease or chronic pain. It changes people. It can change them for the better. It can change them not for the better. It understandably, it makes them somewhat self-focused. It makes them turn inward because they're in pain. They're enduring hard things. And that story largely becomes about them and you coming alongside them. And so it really changes the relationship dynamics. It was mother-daughter, but it was also sick person caring for a sick person. And that's a really different dynamic. So when she would call and say, "Can I visit on this date?" She actually didn't ask Gary. She would just say, "These are the dates I'm coming to see my grandkids." And because she was sick and she could die, you know, I had to say yes, it felt like, for a lot of those years.
Yeah.
And that was a difficult thing. And that was something that I was able to share with my community, my church, my friends here. And they knew when I said, "Mom's visiting, please pray for me," they knew what I meant. They knew that it would be this intense time where she would want to squeeze every drop of life out of me and my kids and have this full experience, and that it felt like being hugged by a boa constrictor in some ways. It was just exhausting. And none of us knew how long the race was. None of us knew where the finish line was for her, if she was going to die this year or if we had another 5 years. We didn't know. Yeah. So to be able to pace myself to, you know, she would leave and I would have to go talk to my pastor. I feel like garbage because I am so annoyed by her. I'm struggling in this relationship. Yeah. I feel like a teenage daughter again, because I feel like there's not room for me to be my own person because her experience is so consuming. It's so the center of what's going on with our family. And, you know, but because I was able to acknowledge that, I think in God's kindness, he did heal some of that near the end. I talk about in the book that there was a time near the end, about a month before she died, where she wanted to visit. And I said, "That doesn't work for me, Mom. Dad's visiting that weekend. I can't do that weekend." And she said, "Okay, what does work for you?" And I held the phone away from my ear. I was like, "Is this my mom? Am I talking to my mom right now? Is this the same person?" I mean, it was the one time she could have said, "No, I literally am dying and I get to come when I want to come." She didn't. And she said, "You know, what works for you?" And that was kind of the beginning of her spiritual healing, her letting go of this world, reaching for the next. And it healed deeply some of those wounds of the relationship being about her all those years. And there at the end, she mothered me and she let it be about me for a minute, even in the midst of her suffering. And that I just see so much of God's kindness in that. And that was only because I was able to say, "This is hard." And God said, "I know. I see you too. There's room for both of you to suffer. And one doesn't have to trump the other when we're talking to the Lord about it or in our Christian community. It can be both."
I think a lot of our listeners who are living with this reality of a long-term illness are identifying with what you're saying, you know, mixed emotions, mixed feelings, you know, from day to day in terms of what's happening. You mentioned earlier the loss of her hair, which came from the chemo that she was taking, and the treatments and all of that. How did that affect you when you saw how different she looked?
Yeah, when I was in the seventh grade, it was, you know, significant. I remember having compassion for my mom because hair was everything to me. I would just miss the bus trying to curl my hair perfectly, you know, and my mom lost her hair. I mean, it was this gut check on my superficiality at the peak of my superficial years. I was like, does this really matter as much as you want it to matter? Your mom is downstairs fighting for her life and you're curling your hair. So it was a sweet kind of, this world really is passing away. Do I really believe what scripture says about jars of clay and my, you know, appearance not being everything? And then as her cancer came back, and the second time she lost her hair was right after my first daughter was born. So my kids never knew her with hair. And it's funny because when I was growing up, she had brown hair. She was brunette. My whole family is brunettes. And then after she lost it the first time, she dyed it blonde. And so for the first time, people said, you and your mom look alike. And I was like, oh, we do, you know. So in my brain, she's those two people. She's the brunette. She's the blonde. And my brain could not really comprehend the hairless version. It just wasn't my mom. That was my kid's grandma. That was who they knew. And it was a different season of her. And I just, something in me subconsciously didn't want to know her that way or remember her that way. I wanted to protect the way I saw her in my mind. And so I didn't, you know, I would take pictures and, you know, it's just her arms or the bottom of half of her smile. Like I was subconsciously cropping her hair or lack of hair out of these photos and these memories. It didn't bother my kids because that's how they knew her. But for me, it was just this really subconscious struggle of, oh, she looks sick, you know. And so it was hard. I think there's nothing else to say. It was hard. I don't know if there was a healthier way to go about it, but that was one of the ways I processed it was, oh, this is hard to look at. This is hard to deal with.
Yeah. I remember when my wife had cancer and went through chemo and lost her hair. Of course, she's fine. And it was 12 years ago and she's still living and she's healthy and all. But we didn't know. You don't know, you know, when all you're going through all that, whether death is imminent or whether it's going to be down the road somewhere. But I remember the wigs and the hats, because she didn't want to see, people without hair. So she had wigs, and I think she had 20 or 30 different hats that she wore during that time. But she calls that her lost year, because it was a whole year, you know, that she went through that. But we're just so grateful that it was effective for her, you know, and then she has no sign of cancer now. So, but that's not normally the outcome, as all of us know. So you say that she seemed more radiant as she got closer to death. Say a word about that.
Yeah, and I wonder if it was God's work in me to see her the way that he was seeing her, you know, as there is this layer of as your body shuts down, as you reach the end of your earthly life, you're coming alive to your spiritual life, to, for a believer, you're coming alive to your future hope. And it's becoming real. It's dawning. And other people I've heard talk about this too. It's like you're seeing at the end of a day, like the dawn of the next day. And you couldn't really imagine it beforehand. And scripture uses all this poetic and language about, you know, an acorn. My language is the acorn becoming the oak tree, because we have one in our yard. That's what I talk to the kids about when they ask what grandma looks like now. I say, well, I can't say what her future body will look like, but I know that it will be as different as the acorn is from the oak tree, and as different as a kernel of wheat from a field of wheat. And so I guess I got to glimpse that as her body was shutting down, and you know, she'd been on all these treatments and all this that had these effects, but there was kind of this glow that began to dawn on her. And maybe I imagined it. I don't know. But I was able to look at her again. I was able to fully look at her and take in this frame of the person who had loved me, brought me into this world, and just the gift of getting to see her hope dawn, her future hope become reality. There was a radiance to it, you know, like Moses' face became radiant after he saw God. And there was just a layer of that. It was a thin place where heaven and earth seemed to hold hands for a minute. And I got to see by being there, her hope become true. Yeah. And it has given me, you know, I walked away saying, everything we believe is true. That's the thing I told people that day. I can't even describe. I'm struggling to describe, and I struggled to describe in that book why I knew that. But I think other people who've been there would also say the same, that there was just a sense that the thing that was happening was truer even than the reality of death, that the hope that she was coming alive to, it was something in me resonated with it. Like, this is what we're waiting for. And so while I'm devastated that I won't get my mom Earthside anymore, I felt like, you know, more like a bridesmaid walking her to her groom than a grieving daughter in that day.
Mm. Yeah. That's a beautiful picture. I like that. You know, as you wrote this book, of course, you're looking back on the whole experience. Was it important to remember not only the good times, the positive moments, but also the conflicts that you alluded to earlier?
Yeah, that was really important to me. It's hard to do well. I think we want to honor our loved ones so much, and so we don't want to, we shy away from going there about certain things. And of course, this is not a tell-all. I did not put everything in there. But I do want to ring true to reality for people. I don't want someone who is in my boat, you know, as I was, that emotion of, oh, I just had this visit with my mom and it didn't go well. And I feel like a bratty teenager because I have all these emotions that I don't know what to do with. I don't want to chide that person. I mean, I've had people chide me like, well, you have to be nice to your mom. She's dying. And I'm like, yeah, but she's been dying for 20 years. I mean, how do I, you know, it's a marathon. How do you lean on the Lord to love difficult people? Well, you can't do it if you don't acknowledge that they're difficult or that the relationship has been difficult for you. And it was difficult for her too, I'm sure. There was, you know, just it introduced this whole layer of difficulty. And that is part and parcel of life in a fallen world. I mean, you have these relationships that are affected by the shadow of death. That's hanging over them. You don't know how much longer you have with each other. And it's having all these impacts. And to not be honest about that, I don't think helps any of us. Because the goal is not to say my mom was a saint and an angel and she did no wrong. It's to say, look at how God was at work in her weakness and my weakness. How God was at work to redeem her, to bring her to full life on the other side of death. And I think I was able to see that because I was honest about how hard it was at times. And I want people to have hope in the midst of, man, my loved one is dying and this part's really hard. We're fighting about end of life wishes, or we're fighting about that vase that my, you know, sister and I want to fight over, whatever it is. There's so many conflicts that arise in the face of death. And that is normal. That happens. And I just want to offer people, like, I just want to sit with them in that and say, you are not alone. This is part of the dying process too. Sin affects every single aspect. And yet Christ is with you. And he wants to work in those, like, really confusing situations where you're not sure, am I the bad guy? What's going on here? That he is at work in the midst of conflict to transform you even then through conflict.
Yeah. I think especially as Christians, we often don't want to talk about those negative feelings that we have along the way in this journey. You know, we want to act like we think Christians are supposed to act and that is have seeing God's hand and being positive all the time. But the reality is we are human and we do have emotions, and there are conflicts that often develop in families around the death of a loved one. So, yeah, I think your honesty and your openness in this book is gonna resonate with a lot of people.
Whitney, what would you say to the person who right now is anticipating the death of someone, and they have that tension on the inside of, you know, but we have conflict and I'm struggling with my struggling. What would you say to that person?
Yeah, I mean, that is where the gift of the Holy Spirit really matters. And good counselors. I had near the end, I felt like, okay, my mom is dying. And she made an about face and wouldn't talk about it with me. No, I'm not. Let's talk about the next treatment. And that was really difficult for me because there was a conversation where I had to be brave and say, Mom, you might have your own process going on. You might need to be strong and keep fighting. But can I feel differently? And can I tell you how I feel? And I said, you know, I feel like you're dying. And so when I come at Thanksgiving, I'm going to have a hard time being happy because that's really hard for me. And I just need you to know and expect that I'm going to be sad. And I hope that's okay because I just can't fake it at this point. And she said, yes, that is so, I'm sure that's so hard for you. And that was like, ugh, to have her be there for me when it was about, I mean, it was her suffering, it was her trial, her death, but she entered into what I was feeling. And that, that healed a big wound for me. It began to heal it, but only because I exposed it and said, entrusted God with it. There was a holy restlessness that I felt as death was drawing near. And I would say, respond to that, whatever that is for you. Man, I don't want to have this conversation, but I'm afraid of not having it. Just go there because people change dramatically as death draws near. And the person you thought would never change and for 20 years has not changed could change at the end. I mean, they could. There's an openness there that I found that was shocking to me. And it was like the Holy Spirit was helping us communicate in a way that hadn't been there because we were just operating. What was happening was spiritual, not just physical. And so we were able to communicate and see each other in a new way that was really beautiful. And I want that for people.
Hey, thanks a lot for listening to the podcast of Building Relationships with Dr. Gary Chapman. I want to send you to buildingrelationships.us to find out more about your love languages, to take the free assessment, and to get some resources there, like the book that we're talking about today with Whitney Pipkin, We Shall All Be Changed. How Facing Death with Loved Ones Transforms Us. You can find a link to that at the website. You might send somebody else there who's walking through these deep waters like Whitney is talking about today. buildingrelationships.us. Thanks a lot for listening and for sending this to somebody who might need to hear it as well.
Whitney, all of us remember the story of Jesus at the tomb of Lazarus. And the shortest verse in the Bible simply says Jesus wept. What comfort did you find from those words from Jesus?
I think that chapter 11 of John is so helpful for people that are in that caregiving role or walking with a loved one, because that is our experience. We are like the sisters who are saying, Jesus, our brother is sick. Where are you? Why aren't you here? Why aren't you doing what I've been praying for you to do? And, you know, Jesus tarries at a distance. And then when he comes, he doesn't say, I'm about to resurrect your brother. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. So he tells them, what you need in your grief is me. Not the answer to your questions, not even necessarily earthly healing, but I am the hope in your grief. And then he doesn't rush to the resurrection either. He stops and Jesus weeps with them. And so our Savior made time in what seems like an urgent situation to grieve and to tarry in grief with these sisters, even though he knew he would resurrect right then. And so I think that's where Christians can really grow in modeling and being like Christ. We want to rush to that resurrection. I mean, we want Easter Sunday joy all the time. And I don't think we get the fullness of it if we don't tarry at the cross, if we don't tarry in that Holy Saturday that's like, they didn't know he was going to rise from the dead. Their hope was dead. And we feel that way in our own death. You know, there are people who really thought God was going to heal, really prayed that he would, and have a crisis of faith. And these sisters had a crisis of faith. They knew Christ could save their brother, whom he loved, and he didn't. And so the way that Christ met with them, I think, is such a picture of how Christ met with me in my grief, of just his presence, and that was enough. that it was accomplishing something in me to understand that even in the face of death, he is the resurrection and the life. He is the one we cling to when we don't know how long until our loved ones will be seen again, when we don't even know what happened to them. We don't know if they trusted in Christ. In all our unknowns, he meets us, he sits with us, and he weeps with us. And so that makes that process, that grief, valuable, because it is a time where we share in the sufferings, we fellowship in the sufferings of Christ, and he fellowships with us.
Yeah. You know, over and over in the Bible, we read the words, I will be with you, I will be with you. I was reading it just this morning in the book of Genesis when God said to Jacob, go to Egypt, take your whole family. I will be with you. I will be with you. Those words are powerful because it's the awareness that we're not walking the road alone. Now, in that journey of not walking alone, you talk about the value of friendships, friends who will walk with you through the journey. And you write in the book, and I'm quoting here, it was my closest friends who gave me something I didn't know I needed as time marched on and mom's cancer remained. Permission to have my own process. They let this trial be not only about my mom, but also about me sometimes. So talk about the value of friends during this experience.
Yeah, I mean, I talked earlier about how, you know, our loved one that's in it has a different experience than those of us who are in the kind of supporting role, the supporting actors in the story. And I saw it as a Venn diagram. You know, there was times where mom and I would have the same emotion to the stimulus, to the latest doctor's appointment or whatever. And there were many times where we had completely divergent reactions. She would take it as good news. I would take it as bad news. And I couldn't and didn't want to make her get on the same page as me, but I needed somehow to breathe and have, you know, be able to express what I was feeling to people that were just there for me. I mean, they knew my mom, but they could give me room to have a different set of emotions around what was going on. And that was my church family and friends and, you know, and my husband and my kids, you know, as time has gone on, all of those people I've just learned that we think we have to like be strong for our loved one. And that doesn't actually work. Like, you know, when we are able to be weak with others and say, I am really struggling with this. I'm having a totally different experience than my loved one based on what just happened. Then we invite others in and we get to experience God. I just think that's God's design to be, yeah. It is not good for man to be alone, right? And so it is good for us to allow others in. And I don't know, I've always been afraid of being like too much for people. My sister and I both do this because our mom had cancer for so long. So she could, you know, come to Bible study and her prayer request would like trump everybody else's. And so I am like so afraid of doing that to people, of one-upping them with my suffering or my prayer request or whatever. And yet I found as I trusted people and said, this is what's going on and it's hard for me, that, and I was there for them too. It wasn't a one-way street. It blessed them to encourage me, to be there for me. I wasn't too much for them. And it was, you know, whereas it may have been too much for my mom to handle, to go to her with what I was feeling. But in God's kindness, he made other people who could see me. And it was a reflection that God saw me and that I was not too much for God. That what I felt, as we see in the Psalms, there is room for all of it. And that it is good to bring it to the Lord and to our community.
Yeah. And I think sometimes as friends, especially Christians, that we try to talk people out of their emotions. You know, we say, well, you shouldn't feel that way because you know God is with you, da, 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 da. Rather than allowing them to be where they are and being there with them. So I just think, you know, that whole thing of weeping with those who weep is an important part of friendship. And not always trying to preach to the person, but just being there with them, you know, and processing things, and allowing them to be where they are.
So, my favorite words have become, that's so hard. I mean, that's just, that just makes me feel seen. And I love to say that to others. That sounds really hard. Just to validate like their experience. And that's enough. That's often enough.
Yeah. You know, we have often mixed feelings and mixed thoughts. We're longing for the suffering to end when we see a person suffering over the long haul. But we're also longing for them to stay, you know, to make it through, to be still be here with us. And those two are also conflicting thoughts that we have along the way, right?
Yeah. I have a chapter where I compare birth and death because I saw a lot of correlations. And I gave birth to my third child about 4 months before my mom died. So I saw, and I think anyone who's been pregnant for 9 months understands that there comes a point where as much as you don't want to give birth, you are ready to get this over with. And you get that way with death, where you've seen your loved ones suffer, and you get to a point where you're like, I do not want them to live this day any longer. I want this day to give way to her eternal rest, to her ending of the end of her suffering. And that can seem weird to people who haven't been there. Maybe it wasn't selfish. It was, I wanted her to no longer suffer. And so as much as I wanted her to be there for me, I mean, my sister and I said, you know, we told mom, you're wondering what they're waiting for. You don't know. The hospice comes in and says, okay, they're in the final stages. And you're like, what does she need to hear from us to feel like she can go? And you feel this urgency to give her permission to go, even though you don't want her to. And my sister and I said, you know, we kind of lied to her and said, we'll be fine. We'll be okay. We didn't know that we would. But you say these things to free them to the process that's happening, that's inevitable. And you begin to long for the end of their suffering more than you dread the beginning of yours. That's how I would explain it, I guess. It's both and still.
Yeah. Whitney, talk about the day your mom died.
So it was the Saturday after Thanksgiving. We had been there all week. We didn't think she would die that week. We thought maybe she'd make it to the new year. We thought maybe it'd be our last holiday together. And we got there, and it was like every day was a new. Hospice came in on Wednesday. She didn't know they were coming in. Like, it was a blur. Every day was different. But then on Saturday is when she died. So Thursday, we brought in oxygen, and on Thursday, she was able to kind of understand what was happening and have those moments that we've been praying for, those moments of clarity and making that pivot toward finishing her race well. And then hospice told us that often mothers will not want to pass with their children in the room. And so that Friday night, we finally slept after many nights of, my sister and I were both nursing babies, so we were like just so drained and exhausted. And so we finally slept Friday night thinking maybe mom will go, you know, with her husband at night. And the next morning she was still there, and we were grateful. We wanted to be there. And so we were in the room with her. It was Saturday afternoon, and she had had the restlessness stages and then was kind of in this peaceful stage. And my sister was changing clothes in the bathroom. I was like, Allie, get out here, because I heard the kind of the rattly breath, and I sensed it was happening. And so my sister ran in, and we were both with her, as well as our friend who had been a hospice pastor and driven down to be with us. We were all in the room, and then the kids and her husband and everyone came in right around then. I don't know if they were in the room right then, but we had a moment. You know, we had some time with her body as well. Yeah, it was, I saw the color drain, and yet I knew that she was no longer here, and that we had witnessed the full reality of what we believed coming true.
Yeah. What were your feelings at that moment?
I was like grateful that the marathon, the physical marathon of midwifing her through death was over. I was exhausted. I was physically exhausted. I mean, it's physically laborious to do the work, especially with a quote fighter like my mom. I mean, you're like fighting her. You know, it's like it was physically demanding. And I was also a little bit, we were kind of like slap happy and relieved, I would say, which is weird, I think, unless you've been there. But we were just so glad she finished well, and that we finished well, that we helped her have a good ending, that God answered that weird prayer that I had begun to pray, that she would have a good ending, and that the story I couldn't have written of her death, that it just was unfolding before me, and I felt like I'd experienced something unique in it being condensed in that 5-day period. I was able to see the spiritual layers, the physical layers of what had happened. And, you know, that's why I went home and I wrote like 25 pages of everything down. And then later that became the book. In the moment, it was just, you know, when you witness something kind of spiritually and you're like, I'm going to doubt that that was real later. Mm-hmm. I need to write that down so that I don't disbelieve my memory of how God was real in that situation, because it is indescribable. And it is, you know, we shall all be changed. It is unique. And I wanted to testify to that.
Whitney, is that where the title comes from? Right from scripture?
Yeah, it is. Even though it's not, you know, literally about the dying process in this way, it's about how we will be changed in our resurrection. A friend said this book is really about resurrection, which was striking to me, that in death we cling to that resurrection. It becomes more real, more necessary, more assured, more imaginable. And that, and I am applying the way that we see our loved one die, the way that we witness the change that's going on, and wanting people to have hope that that change is also occurring in them, in those who are left behind, that there is a transformation that will continue in them as they grieve and as they meet with Christ in their grief.
Whitney, talk about the reality, the hope, the assurance that we have of heaven and living in tension of wanting our tears wiped away, but we're still feeling grief. You know, we've got these positive realities and feelings about heaven, but we still are sensing the loss of the one who gave us life, in your case.
It's like there's a kind of a harp string between me and my mom, not literally, but it's not always there. I'm not always aware of it, but there will be something that sort of thrums that string and reminds me of that hope that I witnessed and that I'm walking toward. It'll be a hymn or a song or one of those moments where you realize your loved one's not here, and I come alive to that future hope in a way that puts my present reality into perspective, that makes whatever suffering is going on feel light and momentary for a moment as I remember the weight of glory that's coming. And I am grateful that I have that thread, that it was always there to some degree between me and my future hope, but that having someone on the other side makes us think of it more often. It makes it kind of thrum in reality a little more often. And it is something that we are desperate for. And because we're desperate for it, We look for it, we seek it, and we're able to sense that it's true as well.
Yeah. In the book, you share that your mother wrote in her journal these words: "Here we are at the cliff, waiting to find out if there is a bridge to here, that is life here, or a bridge to you, Jesus. Help me to walk this next chapter, long or short, with grace and faith beyond my feeble belief." Did you discover that in her journal before she died or after she died?
After she died, yeah. And it was really healing for me, because I think she protected us from the fullness of her laments with the Lord. She had kind of this like positivity vibe toward us that bothered me, that I was like, Mom, tell me how you really feel. And so to see her journal and to see that she had that conversation with God, she had wrestled with God over the length of her life, over her time with us. And she had said, even if, with God, that she had said, even if you don't give me more time, I trust you. I trust that you'll be good. I trust that there's something good that you have me walking toward. And I'm willing to let you have the reins here. And that was so healing and helpful for me, that she was, you know, letting go of this life and reaching for the next in a way she didn't always show her daughters. She didn't want us to see the fullness of that grief and that lament. And yet I'm so grateful that she did that grappling with the Lord, because I think that's where the value is for each of us, to be able to say, you know, like Jesus did, take this cup from me. Not my will, but yours be done. And we don't say the second without the first. We say our prayer. We say our full wish and hope in the face of death. And then we say, even if you don't, even if you don't rescue me from this fiery trial, you are still good. You will still be glorified. And I am still running toward a hope that is more true than the reality of death.
Whitney, I'd just like to say a word to our listeners who may be the one who has cancer or some disease, and they know that death is nearer, or at least it appears to be nearer. Writing something like this about your relationship with God and leaving it in your journal or somewhere with family members can be very, very helpful to them. It's a way that you can have a ministry in their life. Now, having said that, as we come to the end of our time on this program, what are some of the things that you tell people who are about to walk through this, you know, with a loved one? What in closing, what would you say to them?
Those days of walking toward the end are such a blur, and yet they are an experience of being carried along by God. Of knowing a Savior who went through death and didn't skip any parts of it, went through the fullness of it for the joy set before Him. So we get to walk with Him. We get to be carried and held by Him. We get to experience Him uniquely. And so I would want them to show up for that process in their own life. I would want them to show up with great hope for what God can do in the life of that loved one, whether they trust in Christ or not, that that is a place we want to be. You know, when God says in Psalm 23 and that He will be with us in the valley of the shadow of death, then that's a really valuable place. That's a place that we want to spend time with others and with the Lord. And I would say, don't forget to eat and sleep are the main grief. And that process is so embodied and it is so wearisome. And so while you are being carried along, let Christ care for you. Often through his body, the church, you know, let people bring you meals, let people do your laundry, let people take your kids, you know, take that space that you need, because when you feel that restlessness, like I need to process, I need to sleep, I need whatever this is, you know, listen to that, because it's not self-care, it's receiving Christ's care for you, that you don't have to perform right now. He has done the work that needed to be done for your salvation. He's the one who died after living a perfect life and who rose again and who achieves our resurrection. So we can rest even as we do the work of walking well with loved ones. We can rest fully in Christ's finished work. And that is our hope at the end of their life and the end of our own.
Well, Whitney, I want to thank you for being with us today, and thank you for investing time and energy to write this book. And I think anyone who's listening today is going to find help in this book. So thank you, and may God continue to guide you in your life and your ministry. So thanks again for being with us.
Thank you so much.
Once again, the title of Whitney Pipkin's book is We Shall All Be Changed, How Facing Death with Loved Ones Transforms Us. We have it linked at the website, buildingrelationships.us. Again, go to buildingrelationships.us.
And next week, a couple on the brink of divorce tells their story of transformation.
Don't miss Tim and Kathy Bush's story in 1 week. Our thanks to Janice Backing and Steve Wick for their work behind the scenes. Building Relationships with Dr. Gary Chapman is a production of Moody Radio in association with Moody Publishers, a ministry of Moody Bible Institute. Thanks for listening.